victory is found in you, is found in you.
Praise the Lord. It's great to be in the house of the Lord this morning. Amen. Amen. Just a couple of quick announcements. If you have any handyman skills or handywoman skills, Bob is out back this morning with a clipboard. He'd love to sign you up. We could use anyone who could do some painting, some drywalling, electrical plumbing, and general. We'll just throw that out there so you're just in it. Also, please sign up if you have any time for the Fall Fest. That's one of the bigger events that Crow Hill does. And we reach a lot of people, so if you can spare some time on that Saturday, that I think is October 22nd, if you could sign up for that, we could really use your help and appreciate it. So this morning, let's just continue our worship.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life sent with you. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all full of sake became so here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. And I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether love. altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
Amen.
Adore you. Holy, holy, holy
all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
Jesus, we give you glory and praise. Lord, the book of Revelation says that they continue to cry out, holy, holy, holy are you, Lord, who was and who is to come. And Lord, I pray that we wake up every morning and we shout out, holy, holy, holy are you. Lord, I pray for protection over our church at this time, Lord. I pray for the search team as they continue to do your work. I pray for anyone who is sick this morning, Lord, that you can just send down a blessing of healing, Lord. I pray for anyone who's going through some bad times right now, because as we know, it's always rough when it's in the valley, Lord. But I pray that you show them that there is sunshine and that you are there with them with your arms wrapped around them, Lord. I pray for our community. And Lord, I just pray that again, every morning we get up singing holy, holy, and give you praise and honor in your precious name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning, everybody. So nice to see all of you today. Great. Good. It's good to be back. It's been an interesting couple of weeks. As many of you know, or at least like most of you know, I've been in Ethiopia, and just an amazing, really amazing trip on a lot of levels. This was my second trip since I started kind of being the CEO, if you will, of this ministry, and it was just great. We were able to get our staff together, took them away on a retreat. We had a church in Charlottesville, West Virginia, that sent a team out to do a VBS for all of our MK kids, and that allowed the parents to hang out together, and I did a staff retreat with them. We spent a lot of time in worship, a lot of time in prayer, a lot of time in the Word, and then we had fun. I think the most fun for me was last Saturday afternoon. We got in a boat and decided to go out on a lake infested with crocodiles and hippos, and that was an amazing experience. It was so good. The only problem is we got really, really close to the crocs, and one of our guys had a drone. And so he flew that drone literally right over the head of the crocs. It was wild. But that was really cool. But then the hippos, they got agitated. And the guy riding our boat was a little concerned, didn't want us to get tipped over. So bottom line is we didn't get as close to the hippos as I would have liked. But it was an amazing trip on so many levels, really on so many levels. And I thank you for your prayers. You know, Ethiopia is it's one of the poorest countries in the world. Even though they've made a lot of progress over the last 10 years or so, it's still a very poor country. And when you fly into the capital city, you get into this massive, big airport. It's one of the biggest airports in Africa, if not the biggest. And, you know, you think you're going to see mud huts everywhere. You don't. They've got high-rises, 60-story high-rises in Addis. It's a big city. But then you get out in the countryside, and it's like a step way, way, way back. And so for me, when I flew over there, I was kind of jet-lagged, and so I thought, you know what, I'm just going to spend a couple days in Addis with our fixer. The fixer is the guy that fixes stuff. So when we run into trouble with the government on whatever issue it may be, he goes in and he fights for us. He's an amazing guy. So I thought I'd spend a couple days with him, and I had a bunch of time to just kind of recover there in Addis, so I started taking walks. And, you know, it was really troubling to me, because here's a country with half of the people living on less than a dollar a day. And on the one hand, you've got this big, beautiful airport, and then you've got 60-story skyscrapers, and you think, why would I expect to see what I saw? Because the streets were just filled with people who were begging. And I thought, you know, the strategy would be, okay, you don't want to get their attention, because as soon as they see a Ferengi, that means money, and I didn't want to be the center of attraction. And so I tried to just kind of, you know, if I saw a whole group of beggars over here, I'd walk on the other side of the road. But one day as I was walking along, this little girl came up and grabbed my hand. And I looked down, and here's this little imp, couldn't be more than 4 or 5 years old, and she gripped onto my hand, and she wouldn't let go. And I don't speak the language, but so I said to her in English, I said, well, where's your mommy? And she looked at me and said, where's your mommy? And then I said, what's your name? And she looked at me and, what's your name? A perfect English, no accent, blew me away. And then I said, you need to go back to your mommy. You need to go back to your mommy. This poor little kid, she parroted everything I said, and she wouldn't let go of my hand, and I'm walking along, and here's this little kid, and I'm thinking, this must look bad. I mean, maybe this is some kind of a child trafficking sting that I'm walking into, you know? And she just wouldn't let go, and I'm trying to figure out, what do I do? And finally, an Ethiopian man came walking towards me, and he raised his hand up as if he had a stick, and he yelled at the kid, and the kid ran, left my hand and ran. And I thought, well, okay, got out of that one. And then I'm walking along, and now a woman comes up to me, and she has a little baby in her arms. And I, again, my eyes connected, and that was it. At that moment, she got me, okay? She comes up with a little baby. She holds him next to me, and it's baby food, baby food. And I looked at the baby. I didn't think the baby was starving, but I'm sure the baby was probably hungry. But again, I thought, if I give something to this woman, every beggar on this block is going to be surrounding me. And so I thought, well, I got to figure out. So I smiled at her, and I said, no, no, no. And I walked away, and she just kept walking next to me, right on my shoulder. And it was like harassment, all right? So then I thought, there's a burger place. They have a sign, a logo that looks like In-N-Out Burger. It's not In-N-Out Burger. It's an imposter burger. But anyway, I went in there, and I thought, okay, fine, I can get away. So I went in there. I didn't really want to eat any of the burgers there. But 10 minutes later, I walked out, and here she was waiting for me. And again, baby food, baby food. And she's following me along. Next 100 yards, baby food, baby food. And I'm just trying to stay focused. Don't look at her. Ignore her. Keep going. And then I saw this supermarket, and I thought, okay, let me try this. So I went in the supermarket. I stayed in the supermarket a long time. I came out of the supermarket. Guess who's there? Baby food, baby food. And so now I'm walking along. She's right on my shoulder, baby food, baby food. And finally, an Ethiopian guy's come in the other direction, and he yells at her, and then she leaves. And I'm starting to think, how am I feeling about all this? And then I had two guys around me, 20-year-old guys, one on this side, one on that side, and I'm thinking, I think I know what's about ready to happen here. So the guy over here, he hands something towards me. He's got, I don't know what it is, but it's covered with a towel. And he said, give me something. And I yelled at him, and I said, I know what you're trying to do. You're trying to rob me. No. I just need something. And then I backed up, and I thought, this is going to turn ugly here really, really quick. And anyway, again, somebody came out and yelled at him, and then they left. And then there were two little boys. And I'd heard that in Ethiopia, when a mother out in the villages doesn't have money to raise her kids, she'll put a 5-year-old on a bus and send him to the big city to beg, totally losing connection with the child for the rest of life. But at least now she can care for her kids at home because she has one less mouth to feed. So here's this 5-year-old boy with his little brother, maybe 3, coming towards me. They see me down the way, and they, as soon as they saw me and our eyes connected, uh-oh, here they come, and they come running towards me, and I'm thinking, oh, man, here we go again. And this time, an Ethiopian man jumped in front of me, threatening them with a stick, and chased them away. I wondered, how would Jesus respond to these people? They're the throwaway of their society. They're the people that everybody wants to be invisible. So I met with a missionary because I was really troubled over this. I didn't know if I did the right thing. I mean, is ignoring them the right thing to do? Is what do I do? Do I yelling at them? The only way to get rid of them was to pretend you have a stick to hit them. And so I asked the missionary, what do I do? And I expected he'd tell me the usual things. Don't avoid eye contact. Speak sharply. But he didn't. Instead, he said, Steve, that's one of our biggest problems. More than money, what these people want is to be seen. Everything in their society tells them that they don't matter, that they're not valuable, that their opinions don't matter, that they shouldn't be listened to, they shouldn't be cared for. They're an annoyance, they're a nuisance. They're on the fringe of society. Nobody wants them, and they feel invisible. And he told me this. He said, Steve, rather than giving them your money, what I try to do is I just try to see them. And it really stuck in my head, try to see them. And I don't think I have a solution to the problem. I really don't. Because the minute our eyes connect, it's like, here goes a cycle. But on the other hand, I found myself thinking, didn't he see people? Didn't Jesus see people that other people wouldn't see? Like the woman with the issue of blood who came up in the crowd and touched the seam of his garment. And like blind Bartimaeus, when everybody else was passing down the road and he's crying out, Jesus, Jesus, and everybody's telling him to be quiet. There's only one person that really notices him. To everybody else, he's just white noise. To everybody else, he's just invisible, a nuisance. But Jesus calls him out by name and asks him, what do you want me to do for you? All right, turn with me in your Bibles to John chapter 9. And here's the thing I want to talk about a little bit today. I want to talk about being seen. Because I think that it's not just the beggars in Ethiopia or the beggars, street beggars or whatever. I don't think it's just people that are quirky and down and out on their luck, who lack good social skills, who can be rude, demanding. I don't think it's just people like that that want to be seen. I think everybody wants to be seen. Everybody wants to feel like they matter to somebody. Everybody wants to feel like their opinions are worth listening to. Everybody wants to know that there's got to be somebody out there that thinks they're worthwhile, that their lives have purpose. And one thing about Jesus is Jesus always made people feel that way, didn't he? He asked lots of questions. He drew people out. He engaged with people. He made people that were on the fringes, people that others would hold at arm's length, he drew them in. And he made them feel like they really, really mattered. Well, today we're going to look at a story about that. And in particular, this happens to be about a guy that was born with a congenital birth defect. Now, we're in this series in the Gospel of John called The Seven Signs. And we are on sign 6, by the way. Next week, we'll look at sign 7. But we've seen Jesus turn water into wine. We've seen him heal the nobleman's son. We've seen him heal the lame man at Bethesda. We've seen him feed 5,000 people with 5 loaves and 2 fish. We saw him walking on water. And now we come to the 6th sign, which is in John chapter 9. Now, let me set the context for you. This is a very tense moment in the life of Jesus and his disciples. Pressure has been building for a long time now. There's lots of conversations about him. He's a high-profile figure. The religious leaders are fed up with him. They want him eliminated. They're doing everything in their power to try to bring an ending to Jesus' influence. And when Jesus goes to the Feast of Tabernacles, that's a big deal in Jerusalem. Thousands of people come to the Feast of Tabernacles. And Jesus decides to go. And when he goes, he has a confrontation with the religious leaders that turns heated. And the next thing you know, they're accusing him of being demon-possessed. And they tell him, you're just a son of a whatever. And they're saying horrible things about him. And then they actually picked up stones and threatened to kill Jesus. And amazingly, Jesus is able to evade them. In the crowds of people, he hides himself. And that's the ending of chapter 8. And what happens next, as he is walking along, chapter 9, verse 1, he saw a man blind from birth. Now, to be blind in those days was not a good thing. This is a congenital birth defect. And when somebody is born blind or somebody is born lame, immediately the conclusion is somebody sinned. Whether it was in vitro or the parents, something happened. This kid is born with a defect. Therefore, God has cursed him, and there must be a reason. And so for most people who are born blind, their life was the life on the streets. They were beggars, and they would cry out, food, money. In fact, the word beg that appears in this very text is a word that means to implore incessantly. Money, money, beg, food, food. And that was the lot of this man's life. Nobody wanted to notice him. He'd probably been sitting there ever since he was almost born, begging. For many people, he was just, he's invisible. We don't want to hear him anymore. But Jesus saw him. And I got fixated on that phrase. He saw a man blind from birth. Now, the disciples who were with him, they turned to Jesus and they said, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Now, immediately for the disciples, it wasn't about compassion. It wasn't about this person is valuable, this person matters, this person has purpose. It was about somebody sinned. Who was it? It was a theological discussion for these guys. They viewed this man who was born blind as a theological conundrum. They wanted to have a discussion about what is the cause of his blindness. They didn't see him as a person of value. So Jesus says, well, neither this man nor his parents sinned. Now, that's shocking. He says, this happens that the works of God might be displayed in him, that the purposes of God would be displayed in his life, that the power of God would be displayed in his life. And then Jesus does something absolutely amazing, and this is not the normal medical protocol for these kinds of things, but in verse 6, he spits on the ground, and he makes some mud with the saliva, and then he puts it on the man's eyes. Now, this is not the usual protocol for blindness. And I was thinking about it, you know, did he put it on the eyelids of the guy? I mean, it's like a slash of saliva mud on the eyelids. Or did he actually put it inside the eyeball? I don't know. I can't imagine inside. I mean, this guy, he can't see, but he surely has feeling in his eyes, right? And it does kind of conjure up a lot of questions like, you know, is this like, you know, Jesus, I mean, in the book of Genesis, God, you know, creating man out of the dust of the earth. Is this God creating new eyeballs out of the dust of the earth? I don't know. I'm not sure what to make of it. But it's not the only time it happened. It happened once else in the Gospel of Mark with another guy. Same story in many respects, right? But then Jesus tells this guy, look, he puts mud on his eyes, and then he says, go and wash in the pool of Siloam. In other words, this miracle, I'm not just going to heal you right now. Jesus could have done that right then and there. He didn't even have to put mud on his eyes. He could have just said, eyes be open. And his guy's eyes would have been up. But he didn't do that. Instead, he sloshes this mud on the guy's eye. Just imagine smearing on his eyes. And then he says, go and wash it off. The pool of Siloam was half a mile away. There's crowds of people all over town. And I can just imagine this guy. You know, Jesus says, go, and maybe he has a stick, and he's out there trying to figure out, you know, where's he going, and there's people all around, and he's bumping into people. He doesn't know how to get to the pool of Siloam. He's probably calling out, give me directions. Well, what's somebody going to tell him? You know, turn his body in a certain direction and go that way? And then there's a hill to climb, and then to get to the pool of Siloam, if you've ever been there, you know you have to go downhill to get to the pool. Now, interestingly, the Pool of Siloam was only discovered 10 years ago, and it's an amazing archaeological find because two guys were working on a water main in Jerusalem, and while they were working on the water main, they discovered a couple of curious steps. They brought in the archaeologists, and the next thing you know, they removed the dust from the steps, layers and layers and layers, and they wind up discovering the Pool of Siloam, which was actually built by King Hezekiah hundreds and hundreds of years earlier when Israel was under attack from Sennacherib's armies. So anyway, this guy goes to the pool, and I can just imagine, he gets into the water, and he washes the mud off of his eyes, and all of a sudden he can see. Incredible. Can you imagine the excitement this guy must have felt? Can you imagine coming up out of that water? Oh my goodness, I can see. What an amazing experience this had to have been. And I can just imagine the excitement in his soul. I mean, he's never seen anything in his life. He's never seen an animal. He's never seen a person. He's never seen anything. And now he can see. Incredible. He comes up out of the water. What's the first thing you do? He starts going back to where he came from. He probably wants to go back and thank Jesus. So he heads back to where he came from. And when he gets there, look what happens. Verse 8. His neighbors and those who had formerly seen him incessantly, annoyingly begging, they asked, isn't it the same man who used to sit and beg? Some claimed that it was. And others say, nah, this guy just looks like him. Talk about being invisible. This guy's been begging there for years, and they don't recognize him. And so then what happens? He says, I'm the guy. I am the man. This happened to me. This guy can't be more excited probably about it. Now he can see. I am the man. Well, then how is it that your eyes were open, they asked. And he replied, well, the man they called Jesus, he made some mud, and he put it on my eyes, and he told me to go to Siloam and wash, and I went, and I washed, and then I could see. Now, you'd think these guys would be all excited, don't you? Don't you think they'd be saying, this is amazing, look what God did. How about rejoicing with those who rejoice? How about celebrating? He said, this is incredible, this is a miracle, amazing. But that's not what they do. What do? They said, well, where is this man? Well, I don't know, he said. And you know what they did then? They turned this guy over to the Pharisees. What is wrong with these people? I mean, I get, okay, the disciples, they look at this man and he's a theological conundrum, something to discuss in theological circles. The neighbors, they look at this man and, you know what, this guy's a nuisance, he's a distraction, we don't want to deal with him, so we're just going to turn him over to the Pharisees, the moral police, and let them handle it. Incredible. So then the Pharisees, they deal with the guy, and what happens with them? These guys are not happy people, by the way. So rather than rejoicing with the guy that he can now see, what happens? The Pharisees, verse 15, they asked him how he had received his sight. And he said, he put mud on my eyes. And I watched, and now I see. Now some of the Pharisees said, this man, the man whoever did this, can't be from God because he did it on the Sabbath day. Really? But others said, well, how can a sinner perform a sign like this? So the Pharisees became divided. And they're debating whether or not this healing was legit, because it happened on a Sabbath. Can you believe it? Where are the people who are saying, this is so exciting, we're rejoicing with you, this is amazing, your life has value, God believes in you, he did this miracle on your behalf. Now they're just arguing over who did it because it shouldn't have been done on a Sabbath, right? So then they turned to the blind man again and said, what have you to say about him? It was your eyes he opened. And the man replied, he's a prophet. This guy doesn't know beans about Jesus, but clearly, he did a miracle, so he must be a prophet. And they still didn't believe that the guy had been blind and received his sight, so then they sent for his parents. Now, how do you think the parents are going to respond? The parents ought to be really excited, right? I mean, this is their son. This is the one they love. This is the dear child that has been forced to beg on the streets. They got to be really excited about their son being healed, right? So they call on the parents, and now they're going to interrogate the parents. Is this your son? They said. Is this the one you say was born blind? And how is it now that he can see? Well, we know he's our son, the parents answered. And we know he was blind, born blind, but how he can see now, who opened his eyes, we don't know. Ask him. He's of age. He can speak for himself. Parents, don't you think these guys would be defensive of their son? Don't you think they'd be saying, this is amazing? Instead, they're just kind of like, well, We don't want to get in trouble with the Pharisees because we don't want to get excommunicated from the church. And I mean, that's what happens here. They're afraid. Verse 22, his parents said this because they were afraid of the Jewish leaders who had already decided that anybody who acknowledged that Jesus was the Messiah would be put out of the synagogue. They didn't want to be excommunicated, so they didn't want to come to their son's defense. So they gave this half-hearted, well, he's our son, and he was born blind, but I don't know. We don't know what happened. You ask him. Goodness, it's like this parents almost want their son to be invisible. Well, then the Pharisees, they call the blind man, the former blind man, back in, and they say in verse 24, give glory to God by telling the truth. What do they think, he's going to lie? And then they said, this man who healed you is a sinner. And the formerly blind man says, well, whether he's a sinner or not, I don't know. Only thing I know, I was blind, now I see. Isn't that an incredible testimony? And then they said, well, what did he do to you? How did he open your eyes? And he said, I already told you. You guys don't listen. Do you really want to hear it again? And then they say, do you want to become his disciples too? That might not have been smart. So then they turned on him. They hurled insults at him. And they said, you're this fellow's disciples. We're disciples of Moses. We know that God spoke to Moses, but as for this fellow, we don't even know where he comes from. Now the guy's getting cocky. So he says to the Pharisees, well, that's quite remarkable. You don't know where he comes from, yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners. He listens to godly people who do his will. Nobody's ever heard of opening the eyes of a man born blind. But this man, if he weren't from God, he could do nothing. And to this they replied, you are steeped in sin at birth. How dare you lecture us? And they threw him out. Wow. Talk about this poor guy. Can you imagine his life? For all these years, he's been kept on the fringe, Everybody's viewed him as cursed from God, a sinner, unworthy, unclean, invisible, a nuisance, somebody to avoid. Don't do this. And now, the disciples, he's just a theological discussion. The neighbors, just a distraction to hand off to somebody else. The Pharisees, this guy's a sinner, steeped in sin since birth. And to his own parents, he's just a disruption to their otherwise comfortable life. Talk about being invisible. Well, he's invisible to everybody else except for one person. And who is that person? Jesus. So look what happens. Jesus heard the guy has been thrown out of the temple. So he goes out and he looks for him and he finds him. In verse 35, he says, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" "Well, who is he?" the man asked. "Tell me so that I may believe in him." And Jesus said, "You've seen him. In fact, he's the one speaking to you now." And the man said, "Lord, I believe." And he worshiped him. Isn't that incredible? Aren't you glad that God sees you? I mean, think about all those amazing verses. I think of Hagar in the Old Testament in Genesis 16. She's been banished from her home. She's out in the wilderness. She's got her son Isaac. And it's almost one of those situations of baby food, baby food. And God cares for her, and she says, "I now know El Roy, the God who sees me." Think about Isaiah 35, Isaiah 42. Both those passages says that when the Messiah comes, he will open the eyes of the blind. I think about that verse in 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 12. That says, "The eyes of the Lord are upon the righteous, and his ears are open to their cries." Aren't you glad that God sees you? He sees you. He hears you. He chose you. He endowed you with value and purpose. In Ephesians 2, verse 10, my life verse says, "We are God's one-of-a-kind masterpiece, created in Christ Jesus unto good works that God ordained beforehand that we should do." You're very special to God. You are very valuable to God. He sees you. And what would it be like? What would it be like in church if we saw everybody else the way Jesus sees them? What if we weren't like the disciples who tried to turn everything into a theological discussion? What if we weren't like the neighbors who just thought of that, "Oh, that guy's just he's a distraction, he's a nuisance." What if we weren't like the Pharisees? "Boy, he's just a sinner." What if we weren't like the parents who just wanted to get away and not have anything to do with him anymore? What if we viewed the people around us as being valuable, one-of-a-kind masterpieces of God? What if we viewed people who are different from us, who think differently from us, who act differently than us, who behave differently from us, people that we would ordinarily perhaps be inclined to avoid, instead of avoiding them, what if we saw them? What if we noticed them? What if we took an interest in their lives? What if we asked them questions and listened to their hearts and drew them out? And rather than judging them, what if we tried to understand them? You see, we all have people in our lives that we don't resonate with necessarily. But what does it look like to go out of our way, like Jesus did, to notice them and make them feel valued? And what about in the body of Christ, the church? And what about this church? What about this room? What about the people in this room? I think our natural inclination sometimes is to associate with people that are like us, who think like us, act like us, behave like us, believe like us. But what if there are people in this room that we're not drawn to? We don't resonate with them. Our inclination is to look at their behaviors, their actions, the things they say, and respond in avoidance with them. Make them invisible. I don't want to deal with them. What would happen if the community of God was the kind of community where people who... there were no outliers. There were no people on the fringe. There were no people that felt like I'm second class. There were no people that felt like I'm not a part of the family. What would it look like if everybody in the church felt the sense of I am valued, I matter, I have worth, people respect me, people listen to me, people hear me, people go out of their way to talk to me, I must matter. Wouldn't it be amazing? I think if the church was like that, people outside would look and say, whatever's happening there, I want to be part of that. But what so often happens in church is we trip over each other. And we get annoyed about this, that, or the other thing, and we wind up turning things into theological discussions, or he's a nuisance, or he's a pastor, or he's a sinner, or he's this, or he's that, and distancing ourselves. And we divide people up into boxes, like, here's the box of people that I'm going to hang out with because they are like me, they think like me, they act like me, they speak like me, they believe what I believe, they're just like me. These are the people that are worthy of my time and attention. And then we have this other box. These are the people, we don't really care to even know their names, we don't care really to have anything to do with them, we would just be as happy if they disappeared. They're invisible, and they are not worth my time and attention. Why do we do that? Why do we do that? I do that. I don't want to do that. I don't want to treat people that are different from me that way, because that's not the way Jesus treated them. He went out of his way to make people feel noticed. What would it look like if we did the same thing? Let's bow before the Lord, shall we, as we close in prayer. And I would, I would ask you, I don't have an answer to the beggar problem in Ethiopia. It's way bigger than me. But I do have answers for how do I relate to people around me, in my circle of acquaintances, people that rub me wrong, people that I would just as soon not have to engage with, people who act, say, think differently than me, and I don't necessarily approve of where they're at. And it's easy for me to put them in the box of judgment and to alienate them or hold them off rather than engaging with them. And when you think about that, who are the people you've put in that box? And maybe there's a name that comes to your mind right now, and maybe it's not an exact fit because this person's not a beggar in Ethiopia, or but you know who that person is, and that name is now in your mind. What would it look like for you to take that person out of the box? What would it look like for you to send that note or make that call or sit down and just say, help me to understand? And then what would it look like to even go the next distance, which would be to say something like, how are you perceiving me? What would it look like to have those kinds of honest, open-hearted conversations because we value one another? Lord, we talk about wanting to be like Jesus. And so often for us, wanting to be like Jesus is so vague, we don't think about what it really means. Part of what it really means is that we're going to pay attention to people. We're going to notice them. We're going to notice the people that sit by themselves. We're going to notice the people that are excluded. We're going to notice the people that feel like they're on the fringe. We're going to notice people that others might hold off at arm's length, and we're going to go out of our way to draw them in. Lord, I pray that you would help us to become like that. You know, as I close out this sermon, I close with an illustration. I don't think I'm real good at this thing of noticing people, but every year in our family, whenever there's a birthday in our extended family, everybody gets together and we have a big birthday dinner, and then we go around the room and we ask folks, you know, who would like to say a word of affirmation? And everybody will take a turn affirming somebody in the room. And my birthday was a few weeks ago. I turned the big 6'5", Medicare, all that stuff, and it was a contemplative birthday for me. But the family gathered, and everybody was going around the room, and they were saying, Dad, this is what I see in you. This is what I value in you. And it was amazing to hear all that. But then there was a long pause, and then my sweet daughter-in-law started to weep. And she was seated on the couch across from me. I was over on the seat over here. And she looked up at me, and tears rolled down her cheeks. And she said, Dad, what I love about you is that you see me. Everybody else suddenly got real quiet. And she said, I grew up in a home where I needed my dad to see me, but he didn't have the time for me. He was an alcoholic, he was a womanizer, he was a hand surgeon. He never saw me. And our dear Shani had to prove somehow or other that she was worthwhile to be seen. And that drivenness in her life took her all the way to the point of winning a bronze medal in the Barcelona Games in the high dive. And it was all an attempt. I just need to be noticed. I just need to be seen. And it hit me. My daughter-in-law feels seen by me. And then it hit me. How many other people see seen by me? And how few? And how many people don't feel seen by me? And so my challenge to you, will you this week make somebody who you have not seen, will you decide to see them this week? Okay. Amen. Thanks, guys.
Heart and leave.
Heavenly Father, I pray that we build our lives on you every single day, Lord. I pray that we keep our eyes fixed upon you and put our trust in you alone. In your precious and holy name, we give you thanks and all glory and praise. Amen. Amen. If you will, please be seated.
I went to a motel on Christmas Eve. I intended to end my life. I lived most of my life out of control. I had used drugs and alcohol. I was put out of my home. My wife told me to leave. And as I'm sitting in that room, I noticed a book lying on top of the TV. And I looked down and I saw that it was a Gideon Bible. And I thought, who needs that? And I took my hand and I swiped it off on the floor. Well, it fell at my feet, but it fell open. What I read changed my life. It said, peace I leave with you. My peace I give unto you. Today, I'm a pastor. My family's been restored. My wife has forgiven me. We work together in ministry. All of this because of one Bible in one room and one night. Thank God for the Gideons, and thank God for the Bibles that they put in the motel rooms.
Go ye unto all the world and preach the gospel. Brothers and sisters, we are all partners in the Great Commission. The Great Commission, go make disciples of all nations. This commandment was not given to the Gideons alone, but it was given to the church. It was given to Crow Hill Bible Church. It's a global mandate given to us all. As fellow workers in the vineyard, the Gideons are your missionary outreach to fulfill the Great Commission. Our only goal is to bring men and women, boys and girls, to a saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. We are organized in 200 countries. We publish in more than 109 separate and distinct languages. And this year, we'll give out over 46 million copies of God's holy word. That's two every heartbeat. And that doesn't include the downloads from our Gideon app that provides an entire Bible in written and audio format in over 1,400 different languages. So get on the website at gideon.org or Google up the Gideon Bible app and download your free copy. How do we do it? In two ways. One, by personal evangelizing, personal witnessing whenever possible, one-on-one. And two, by placing and distributing God's holy word in the traffic lanes and cross lanes of life throughout the world. Together, we give out camouflage New Testaments at the Induction Center at 3 o'clock every morning down in Denver as our kids go off to basic training and perhaps war. Together, we're in the hospitals, the nursing homes, the hospice, the soup kitchens, the doctor's offices, the waiting rooms globally. Together, we give out New Testaments to police and firefighters. And of course, we're in the hotels and motels of Colorado and throughout the world. We're in the battered women's shelters, and with your help, both here in Colorado and in almost every country of the world, the Gideons are in the schools, the colleges, and the universities. We're in the jails worldwide. Locally, we're here at Bailey Days, and we're here in the Park County Middle and High School. We're at the Evergreen Rodeo, the Conifer Christmas Parade, the Evergreen Holiday Walk, and on it goes. By giving folks a New Testament, we believe that we are giving them not only the written word, but also the living word. Jesus Christ is the word, the logos. We are giving an introduction or a spiritual handshake, if you will, of Jesus Christ to them by giving them a copy of God's holy word free of charge to all that receive it. Brothers and sisters, with your support, the Gideons are the largest missionary outreach in the world, with over 242,000 men and women worldwide. The Gideons are working for you and for your church 24/7. The sun truly never sets on the Gideon ministry, and it will never set on your outreach when you partner with the Gideon men and women worldwide. The Gideons are the indigenous citizens of the 200 countries that we minister to. And just imagine, they work for you. They represent you and your church as ministers of the Great Commission, whose only goal is to save the lost for Christ. And we invite any of you today who are professional or businessmen to consider joining the Gideons and to help us get the word of God out to a lost and dying world. Just imagine, if you would, just imagine that Crow Hill Bible Church could send out 250,000 missionaries worldwide, all who pay their own expenses. They educate themselves. They provide their own housing, their own transportation. They speak the language fluently. And because they are the indigenous citizens, they can't be deported. They can go places that foreign nationals cannot go. And they are the natural-born citizens in the countries that they serve. They look, act, speak, dress, and have the correct documentation that testifies that they belong there. After all, they are at home. Think about it. On your website, you could advertise that your church supports 242,000 missionaries in 200 different countries. These missionaries speak every language known to man and witness to 46 million souls every year. Isn't that a powerful witness for Crow Hill Bible Church? Wouldn't that be a powerful witness for you personally? The Gideons are totally dependent on the local church. Here in America, we depend on the church for support and membership. And overseas, we depend on the Gideon and the local church members to distribute the word of God to the uttermost parts of the earth. The Gideons try to stay contemporary. Every New Testament we give out has its own GPS. That's God's plan of salvation, or God's GPS, in the back of the book. It will bring you from where you were to where you want to be, from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of light. That's God's GPS. And as you know, after he rose from the dead and before he ascended into heaven, Christ gave his church, his body, one commandment, the Great Commission: go. So together, we are only doing what Jesus commanded us to do. And then he said, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. This Great Commission is being realized. And brothers and sisters, you are there with us every step, every day, every copy, every conversation, every convert. You and Crow Hill Bible Church are there with us. You are there on the east and west side of the Jordan. You're encircling the Mediterranean. You're evangelizing all seven continents and every nationality. You're on both sides of every sea and all shores of the five oceans. You're on every military base, every aircraft carrier, every battlefield. Because of your support, your prayers, the gospel is being preached to the uttermost parts of the world. And now we know that you are busy, but please know that whether you are awake or whether you're asleep, your witness is going out. Somewhere, someplace, a Gideon guy or gal is giving out the word of God, the word that you provided. And yes, we are here to ask you for your support for the ministry of the word and to fulfill the Great Commission. Now, in a very real sense, though, you cannot give to the Gideon ministry. We are a totally self-supporting ministry. All our personal expenses are paid by Gideon men and women, and our national and international expenses are paid by Gideon annual dues. All we ask is that you help us to buy the scriptures. Every gift is welcome, and every gift is appreciated. Each complete Bible is $5. $100 will buy 20. $1.56 will buy one New Testament, and deliver it anywhere in the world that the Holy Spirit needs it. $156 will send your personal witness to 100 people somewhere between Crow Hill Bible and the uttermost parts of this old world. Heaven and earth shall pass away, Jesus said, but my word will not pass away. If God will not forget to reward a cup of cold water given to a weary soul, God will also reward you for all eternity if you give a copy of his eternal word to another one who is hungry and thirsty for God's mercy and grace. And we ask you also to support our Gideon Bible program. Send a card, touch a life, send the word. We'll be taking a retiring offering, so please be as generous as you can. And remember, every copy of God's word comes with a promise from God, the promise of Isaiah 55:11. So shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me empty, but it shall accomplish that which I please. Every copy you give comes with eternal promise and an eternal blessing. So together you are there with us worldwide. You and the Gideons are fulfilling the Great Commission. So come, let us go to the uttermost parts of the earth. Together, let's go. I'd like to thank the elders and the deacons of Crow Hill Bible for inviting us over today. And we'd like to thank you all. May the Lord richly bless you all. Thank you. God bless.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I think I have stayed in hotel rooms on every continent except for Antarctica. And in just about every hotel room I've ever stayed in, open the thing, sure enough, there's a Gideon Bible. God has used this ministry in tremendous ways over the years. If you'd like to give, you designate that on your check. There's boxes in the back. Also, you can stop by the table there as well. All right, let's all stand up together, shall we, as we close in prayer. Lord, it's been good to be together with your people today. I pray that we come out of here today refreshed, encouraged, challenged, motivated to live for the glory of our Savior Jesus. Help us to think like he thought. Help us to act like he acted. Help us to speak the way he spoke. And Lord, fill us with his spirit, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless. Have an amazing week.